Or this afternoon. I'm sorry, I looked that fast. I want to make a few quick remarks before we go into the ceremony. As the Legal and Ethics Committee's chair, I want to start with the legal maxim. It says, non decipitur, qui sit son discipline means, he is not deceived who knows they have been deceived. I say that in reference to some of the things that happened yesterday. In particular, there was a reference to the Health Act in relation to the Directorate of Pharmaceutical Services. And those who read that law, those who believe that we now have a Directorate of Pharmaceutical Services, critically, the law, the way the law is formulated, it is normally put in such vigor that if you are not careful, you read what you want to read. And that is exactly what has happened here. So, and this is deliberate so as to ensure people can sign off the legislation without a lot of contention. So this is what exactly was happening. So we know better now. We know we are not deceived, right? Because we know what we need to do. I just quickly want to remind us. Today we're using the title, doctors, and we have all assumed it. I want to say I have participated along the way, the journey to the title. And at the CPA conference in 1989, I presented a paper at the KICC where we were justifying why we want to do the title. Today we are happily using it. And I remember the international delegates were wow at how what we were doing at that time. Professor Dem, I think you can you remember that. Now we participated and led the great effort that culminated in the clinical allowance. That was a game changer for us when we were being sidelined by everybody. We did not deserve a clinical allowance. You know what? We had been granted a 2,000 allowance, same as the mortuary attendants. I led that effort, and I'm happy we won it. Now, I also want to remind us, I personally participated in the effort that culminated in the PPB as we know it. I was actually instrumental in establishing it by giving it the foundation, an office, and even the money. I was the one who signed off and started an account. Few people usually remember that, even acknowledge that. But that is what it is. I set up the NQCL when I was registrar and gave it the money. And gave it a mandate that was different from the PPB for governance purposes. You have to have checks and balances. We've seen along the way a lot of fights about mandates. Clearly, we cannot forget that we have to have checks and balances. I'm a trained corporate governance, in corporate governance. That's how some of these things, they're very, very critical for us. It's a pity we have had all these fights even today. I participated in the first ever strategic plan of the PSK. Some of it actually informed some of the programs that the PSK has done, particularly the investment, I want to refer to investment, and that strategic plan actually anticipated the formation of a platform for farmers owned by PSK to deal with the drug distribution, pharmaceutical distribution. I want to remind us that, we can't forget. Wangari Maathai told us, let's forget. That is what I'm very quickly trying to help you to remember. As LSU chair, we are participating in advocacy for a proper legal framework. And at APSIA, at the moment, I'm chair of the committee dealing with legislation across the board to deal with all professionals, to empower professionals. I'm currently at what is called the MCA, Multisectoral Initiative Against Corruption. That followed the bombers of Kenya. Because you cannot forget, this country is this mode now, dealing with matters of corruption. Is this a matter that is concerns us here? I put it to you that this is an issue we have to deal with. So I've been involved in an effort as leading the chair of that committee at APSIA to come up with a framework to be put to the government on how to empower professionals, including ourselves. One of the problems we've had, obviously, is about membership. We are talking about compulsory membership. We have had a challenge because Camp 108 does not permit you, you know, to enforce that. Our constitution does not permit you to demand this kind of things. But we're looking for the legal framework that will ensure. And I'm happy the kind of arrangements that have been there currently. gentlemanly arrangement. Fortunately, they are working now, but there are times they have been thrown out and we are left out. So we need to anchor this in law so that we are assured we are not depending on somebody's goodwill. So those are things I want to remind us that are happening. And as a former registrar for the PPB, as a former president, currently a fellow, of course, of the Pharmaceutical Society of Kenya, as I did, trained in corporate governance, and also in legal legislation. I'm trained in how to structure the law. That's how, when you read the law, you must know where the commas are. You must know the meaning is changed. That's why I talked about legal maxim. So, some of the challenges we face, there's been wonderful developments. I must say, it's not all gloom. We've seen wonderful developments. Look at this hall. Look at this wonderful hall. Look at the numbers we have. That's a great opportunity right there. We have also seen an increased awareness about what is the future, what we need to do. This is wonderful. We are seeing growing specialization and recognition there. That is a wonderful development that I have witnessed. And we are seeing a restored relationship, more or less relationship, between the younger pharmacists and the elder pharmacists. I'm sorry, at some point this broke. This unfortunately broke at some point as a result of a certain amount of disrespect for the elders. I'm happy to see this is now happening. It is changing. This is a wonderful thing, and it must continue. You cannot assume these things. You have to work on them. Now, for me, there are negative issues that we also need to highlight. I must point out, I'm sorry, I don't like to be the messenger giving you the wrong message, but you must also be wary about certain developments. Because if you're not prepared for this, if you're not going to deal with this, then they're a challenge. They're going to give us trouble along the way. We have seen an increased marginalization of the profession through changing legislation. That is a fact. I mentioned a few. KEMSA used to have in its structure who is going to be appointed CEO. It changed to become open to medicine. It now changes, as we were told yesterday, that anybody can be KEMSA CEO. Now, clearly, when you think what is the role of KEMSA, what's the mandate of KEMSA? That is a matter dealing with medicines, purely. So when you go in that direction, you are critically marginalizing a pharmacist or the profession in the wrong direction. And you are hitting pharmacists where it matters most. Now, the Health Act 2017, I've already mentioned that. We were, by law, precluded from becoming Director General, all the way down to the County Directors of Health. That is a marginalization issue. Now, for me, CAP 244 has changed to marginalize the pharmacist in putting roles that are pharmacists clearly spelled out in Section 19 and all of that, and bring other people into the technicians and all of that. That's a problem. The KFDA bill proposes to do stuff that only involves a marginal presence of the pharmacist in the governance structure. Those are worrying trends. Community pharmacy space, somebody has mentioned, this is a wonderful interface. It has been flooded by technicians. They call themselves technologies now, and it's a matter of language, it's very important. And they are flooded there, not to mention all the quirks. Yesterday, when we were discussing this with a colleague, he said, pharmacists don't want to go into community pharmacy. And I was shocked. I say, how can you reconcile that with the fact that 400 or so pharmacists are currently unemployed? Those two don't matter. There is a problem. You can't tell me that you have an employment problem and you have a flooding issue by others who are not pharmacists. So the problem is, what have we done to this space that is discouraging pharmacists to get into that very critical space? And I feel it's wonderful to hear the kind of things we can re-engineer, yes. But the community pharmacy must really remain a native place where we can do stuff, where we can create the image. If we say pharmacists are not interested, then we are saying something is wrong at that space. We must deal with that fact. Now, we have had, emasculating language. This idea of commodities, you talk about medicines, and you talk about them as commodities. Gentlemen and ladies, with all due respect, when you call medicine commodities, like sugar, like blankets, I'm sorry, that is when you begin to mess yourself up. That is when everybody say, anybody can deal with commodities, for heaven's sake. Let us move away from this language. It is the meaning language. I don't believe we should do that. We are the ones, and I know MSH, if I remember, this language, to the best of my knowledge, and the first time I started hearing it was through MSH. If I remember, I don't want. I'm sorry, not by this lady here, by somebody who used to be there at some point, who was a pharmacist. So anyway, language matters. Language, very, very important. Now the language again, technologies versus technicians. Where else in the world, by the way, our good guest, do we have this language of technologists? It is technicians, for heaven's sake. Technicians, that is what is the problem we have adopted. We keep talking about technologists. It's a mess up. It is misrepresentation. And that is how we allow the confusion to come in the law, that you are now willing. Technology, somebody must even have a degree. That's a problem. We need to deal with a language issue. That is how the even parliament tells us that now we are moving boxes. Pharmacists is about moving boxes. You know what? When you say the wholesale example, and I will say this with reference to wholesale distribution, how many of us know, really understand the importance of that area of community? That is the gatekeeper. If you have the wrong people, imagine today you open the floodgates to the quacks to do wholesale, to technicians to do wholesale. We have now completely lost it. It may seem like a lower level area, but I can tell you, the moment you open that, you have a whole problem. At the moment, we know what has happened with medicines, availability of mchele, prohibition all over the place, because medicines are all over the place. So for goodness sake, let us avoid this language that is misleading. I'm happy about the paradigm shift that we have to think about the paradigm shift now. I've had discussed here. But we need, I've talked about decreasing attractiveness. I'm sorry, we are seeing now in the schools, when we started, and I teach, we were seeing pharmacy as the most attractive course at the university, attracting the most brilliant students. That is changing, because the perception of the pharmacy degree is seeming to change, that if everybody can do what the pharmacy degree holder is doing out there, what do you expect? What do you expect anybody who's coming to university to do? How is that going to impact on them? So we must be very, very careful. What we are attracting may begin to attract the wrong kind of graduate. The two entry points, I've already alluded to this, technician, technology, the pharmacy degree. You can enter to community pharmacy practice. That we've done because of lack of implementation of the law of 244. That is very clear. We need to deal with this. Yes. Yes, indeed. Yes, I know. So, to move very quickly, I know I needed to say some of these things because they were troubling me. So, and I'll finish. So, I want to ask ourselves, because I don't want to talk about everything. I have no time to do that. Yes, I want to take you forward. Is a UHC an opportunity or a threat? That is a question for us to think about right here. And I've had a lot of good things that we can do with that. Now, the KFDA bill, pharmacy practice bill, we have had discussions on that. We have had many workshops on that. We have taken position on that. And yet, we have been ambushed recently by something else which we are supposed to contend with. We must be very clear that these are positions we must take. These are the developments we must prepare position documents to deal with, even the issue of the Director General. We have to be able to do that. I can tell you, when one of the things we did that referred to clinical allowance, we managed, because through my leadership, we actually did a wonderful justification document, which I presented at the Harambee House to the whole government. By the time I read it through, they said, done. Nobody was going to ask a question, because we had done a thorough document, a thorough justification document. If what I did, Director General, or rather, Director of Personnel of Health and Pharmaceutical Services, we must do likewise. We must prepare a document, detailed, talking about this structure, what we expect. And when you present it to CS, she will see we've done her job. She will respond by saying, yes, this can be done. We must do this as a society, with the leadership of the society. That is very, very important. We must be careful. The relationship between KFDA bill, and I must say KFDA bill is out there. And I'm concluding. The food issue should not be covered by this bill. The food issue is not mandated by the Health Act. That's a challenge we are looking at right now. How to deal with that? Whether CAP 2554 may be revived to deal with this matter, the standards of foods. And as I conclude, what do we need to do to empower the profession? I've already said legal registration measures, implementation measures, enforcement measures, these are need to be done. And most importantly, we must sit together at the same table and agree on how to sit at the table where policy and legislation is done. We must, if you don't do that, then we are in trouble. We are going to continue to be marginalized. And there is nothing more important than that decision, that policy direction. If you don't participate there, then we'll merely be complaining all the time. So I thank you. I think we are... So about the oath now. This oath is based on the Hippocratic Oath. And the principles, there are four, I just remind us. The four principles of the Hippocratic Oath: beneficence, non-maleficence, respect for persons, which is justice, accountability, and there is a fourth one, which has now recently been brought out. This fourth one, which is about self-care, you look after yourself, it has come up because it was realized that the mental health professionals have gotten sometimes caught up in issues, lack of self-discipline, lack of taking care of yourself, and therefore, how can you take care of anybody if you're not taking care of yourself? So I've noted in the recent past, they have introduced this fourth principle. And so our code here is founded on these principles of the Hippocratic Oath. If you read it, it relates to the principles of the Hippocratic Oath, which are those four or five now principles. So for me now, I think it is the right time. Yes, indeed. Yes, correct. So, yes. So as we move to this, it's important to understand that background. That these are some of the things we have done in order for you to understand, pharmacists to understand, that as you were finished your graduate undergraduate program, and we had a big fight even to have it done at the graduation square. We had a big war about that. Eventually, university said these matters will not be handled here. Take them back. So we are now back, but it was understood we must do this. And I'm very happy we have been involved in developing this tool, very important tool, which we must continue to subscribe to, which we must be loyal to. Because that is what signifies our social contract with the public. And it is always a pleasure, you know, when we come to a forum like this, the most appropriate forum, an annual forum, that helps us to remind us of our duty, our responsibility, even those who have taken the oath before, to kind of re-swear renew our commitment to this. And I have the honor and the duty that to be here today. As a fellow of the Pharmaceutical Society of Kenya, as a founder in the many directions I have mentioned, continuing to participate in working for this space, for improved professional space, and all of that, the respect that should come out of it. And we need to ensure that we maintain this spirit of maintaining standards. And that those standards, remember, in the national spirit, we must commit ourselves to doing the right thing, to avoiding corrupt practices. These are some of the ones which are informing some of the things that have happened to us. Because people don't want to do the right thing in the places where they are engaged.